The definition of a maximal ideal is a bit harder. A proper ideal A of R is called a maximal ideal if whenever B is an ideal of R, with these inclusions being true, then you can say either B equals A or B equals R. Effectively, there's no ideal in between A and R, is an intuitive way to think about that. In a picture, a Venn diagram type of picture, if this is R and this is A, there's no ideal properly inside of R in which A is properly inside of that other ideal. There's no B in between, so to speak, A and R. Now you can think about that with a Venn diagram like this, and it's a little bit helpful, but you got to do more if you're going to really understand this concept to make it fully helpful. And thinking about subring lattices is a helpful way to think about some examples. The book does an example with Z36. Let's do another example. Let's consider maybe Z12 or something like that. As with the integers, principal ideals generated by elements in Z12 are the same as cyclic subgroups generated by those elements. Let's try to make a lattice diagram for Z12. You could think of this as the subgroup lattice. You also could think of it as the subring lattice. You've got Z12 itself, which is generated by 1 as a generator of this under addition. It's also the same as the principal ideal generated by 1. What's the next biggest subgroup of Z12? It would contain 6 elements, right? Think about Lagrange's theorem. Z12 has 12 elements, 0 through 11. 6 divides 12. We also have the fundamental theorem of cyclic groups. There's a cyclic group of order 6. It would be generated by 2. Contains 0, 2, 4, 6, 8, and 10. That is the same as the principal ideal generated by 2, because if you think about ring multiples of 2, multiply any element of the ring Z12 by 2, you're going to get a multiple of 2. 1 times 2 is 2, 2 times 2 is 4, 3 times 2 is 6, 4 times 2 is 8, 5 times 2 is 10, 6 times 2 is back to 0, 7 times 2, 14 mod 12 is back to 2. The principal ideal generated by 2 is the same as the cyclic subgroup generated by 2. We also have, that's a subgroup of order 3, also a subring of order, of order 6. It's also a subring of order 6. We also have the cyclic subgroup generated by 3, the same as the principal ideal generated by 3. That consists of 0, 3, 6, 9. 0, 3, 6, and 9, it's got 4 elements. 0, 3, 6, and 9. Putting it over here, not under that one directly, because it's not a subring of this. Right? For example, it's got 3 and 9 in it, whereas this one doesn't. That's both a subgroup and a subring of order 4. What about order 3? It would be the one generated by 4, 0, 4, and 8, which is a subring of this, but not that. Zero, four, and 8. And finally, well, two more to go. We've got this one that's got order 2 generated by 6. It's a subring of this one, but not that one. And then we have the trivial subgroup or the trivial subring generated by zero. What are the maximal ideals in Z12 is the question now. What are the ideals with the property that there's no ideals in between A and R? Certainly not these lower three. For all three of these down here, there are ideals, proper ideals of R in between, so to speak, these two. Yeah, that means these two are the maximal ideals. These are the maximal ideals in Z12. There's no other ideals, no other ideal, proper ideals strictly between Z12 and these ideals. They're both maximal ideals. Maximal ideals are not unique. That could be a misunderstanding people might have, is to think maximal ideals by this definition might be unique. I'm going to think about it pictorially like this. But no, they're not necessarily unique. You can have more than one of them. Do notice that 2 and 3 are prime, whereas 4 and 6 are not. Is that a coincidence? Maybe, maybe not. We do have an important theorem. Very, very fundamental theorem. The last theorem in chapter 14 says, let R be a commutative ring with unity, and let A be an ideal of R. Then it's very similar to the previous theorem we looked at. The factor ring, R by A, in the last theorem, this was a prime ideal if and only if, excuse me, this was an integral domain if and only if A was a prime ideal. In this theorem, this factor ring is a field if and only if A is a maximal ideal. I would say, at least for us, this theorem is more important than the previous one that we looked at 10 minutes ago. We're going to use this theorem a lot. Its proof is harder, but it does, you should study it. It does use exercise 19, which was the first thing we did today. That if one isn't an ideal, then the ideal equals the whole ring. That's very, very relevant for the proof of this. Let's bring it back to an example from last Friday as well. An example from last class, at the end of the last class, we found that if you take the polynomial ring Z3x and mod by the principal ideal generated by x squared plus 1, we saw last week that as a set, we could write this as all linear polynomials plus the ideal as A and B varied over Z3. Remember that? This is an example I also said to study really well. Linear polynomials are good enough for coset representatives. We don't have to use arbitrarily high degree polynomials because we all could always simplify those higher degree polynomials using the replacing every x squared with -1 and x cubed got replaced with -x. X to the fourth got replaced with -x squared, which means ultimately gets replaced with +1. Remember that? There's three choices for A, three choices for B. This had 9 elements. And in fact, it's a field with 3 squared equals 9 elements. By this theorem, that must mean that that ideal that we are modding by is a maximal ideal, right? Because this is a field. I didn't prove it was a field. You're just trusting me. We found a multiplicative inverse of one element in it. Therefore, this ideal, this principal ideal generated by x squared plus 1, is a maximal ideal of the polynomial ring Z3X. There are other maximal ideals. This is just one of them. In fact, there's infinitely many maximal ideals. This is just one of them. It's a fairly nice one to work with because it's a fairly low degree polynomial. A really, really big thing for us here this week and next week leading up to exam three is that this polynomial f of x equals x squared plus 1 has no zeros in Z3. No roots. If you plug in the elements of Z3 into this polynomial, 0, 1, and 2, what do you get? 0 squared plus 1 is 1, not 0. 1 squared plus 1 is 2, not 0. 3 squared plus 1, or 2 squared plus 1 is 5, mod 3 is 2, not 0. This has no roots in Z3. Being a quadratic, that also means you can't factor it over Z3. You can't factor it as the product of two lower degree polynomials because it's got no roots. It's also related to the fact that its degree is 2. That allows you to say that instead of like 4 or something. I can't factor this as a product of linear polynomials. Remember that I said our main application of ring theory is to understanding factoring of polynomials? This is getting towards that. It's called irreducible over Z3. You can't factor it as a product of lower degree polynomials than Z3x. Because of that, that's why we'll see in chapter 17, this is a maximal ideal. Which comes back to, that's why then by this theorem, this has got to be a field. This factoring. It's a field with 9 elements. It's a finite field whose number of elements is not a prime, but is a power of a prime. And these kinds of finite fields get pretty interesting. You might say even kind of fun. It's going to be the most fun part of the course. It's confusing, yes, at first. But with enough practice, we will do calculations in this kind of thing. And they're going to be our, hopefully, most fun calculations. That's the fun. We're trying to look forward to something here for the rest of the course. That's supposed to be the fun kind of thing.